I'm Helena Nobre. This is an exploratory study developed with Ana Sousa. Ana is not here. I hope to make this attractive to so many people from archaeology and cultural heritage. I'm going to look at the cultural heritage and archaeology on a marketing perspective. So, the main purpose of this study is to explore our archaeology, because this is an exploratory phase. I hope to develop more the study, explore our archaeological and cultural heritage knowledge, leverage country branding, and contribute to developing a competitive nation identity. I will define country brand, and I will or country brand image, and I will define competitive nation identity. Let me explain. Anna did a PhD in country brand, and then we developed some publications in the field. And in this context, this rich context of archaeological people, let me tell like that, called like that, we decide to connect this notion of country brand and country brand image to archaeological sites and cultural and other cultural heritage. So we are interested in, we look at the public as the market. So the market in marketing is a set of consumers. So here our consumers are our visitors, tourists, indigenous community, local citizens, and so on. So we are interested also with this study in progress, as I said, to identify the co-creation activities involved in building an heritage country image. Also, we are interested to understand the role of visitor experiences and community experience as well, and engagement in this dynamic process. Okay, so country image. In marketing, an image is also is always a response from the market. Okay, so in this case, the country image is defined as the perception about a country based on a number of individual assessments, the consumers, if you want, some of which are rational and cognitive, some of which are based on affective and emotional process. Of course, they imply behavioral intentions. So sometimes country image is defined according to three dimensions, cognitive, affective, and behavioral intention. We know from the literature, and you know from our experience, that country economic development is political and international, the country's economic development and its political and international policy, as well as the attractiveness of its culture, contribute to boost the country's reputation and the brand national identity. So we are using the notion of a framework, a notion of competitive identity. What is a competitive identity? Competitive identity is a construct that came from, was developed under the development of this framework, the National Brand Index, proposed in 2005. And this framework was proposed to assess the competitiveness, is a way to assess the competitiveness of a brand, country brand identity. According to this framework, we have six main dimensions: exports, government, tourism, culture, people, and immigration and investment. Of course, we are here very concerned with the cultural dimension. Global perceptions of a nation's heritage and the country contemporary culture. And you are also interested in tourism. Tourism is about how our country can attract visitors to visit the sites, to visit, to feel the city's atmosphere, to visit the country, and so on. So, some theoretical background in marketing regarding the notion of value co-creation. So we also brought this concept to the research because it is related with all this new dynamic, a new marketing paradigm, if you want, in particular in branding, a new branding paradigm as well, that considers that a brand is built in interaction and collaboration with its consumers. So the brand is the experience, or the experience is the brand. So every interaction and experience that consumers have with the brand helps to build the brand image, and nowadays we believe also the brand identity. So it helps every time they give us feedback, they participate in product development, they give ideas for advertising or whatever, for branding communication, they are co-creating value. Okay? So we believe that visitors, in their interaction with the environment, the archaeological sites and other cultural heritage, and with their feedback, and mainly communities, when they interact and help to keep memories and to preserve memories and to build knowledge, they are also co-creating value. So the experience, we know from the literature that the experience, according to this new paradigm, this paradigm shift, the experience that citizens, communities, visitors, or archaeological tourists developed with archaeological, historic sites and other cultural heritage can be a source of brand meaning and value in terms of community identities and national narratives. So, we did this exploratory framework to guide our study. The study that is, this is only a small part, the first initial, very initial phase. So we, and of course we based on some research that we already developed and on the literature on the field, branding in this case. So we know that country familiarity impacts country image. So country heritage familiarity will impact country image. So we assume define country image, as I said before, with two dimensions, country cognitions and country affect, that will impact country visit intentions. Okay, it will impact country visiting intentions, in country investment intentions, country product brand purchase intentions, and so on. For example, just to give an example, in the thesis of Anna and the related articles, we consider tourism a product category. So here, archaeological tourism can be assumed as a product category. So, these visitor can have the role of a co-creator through his experience and interactions with heritage, with the country, a co-creator of heritage, archaeological country identity, and of course, according to one of the goals of this WG working group, WG3, social media can hear the link, an important link in this process. So we ran 7 in-depth interviews because our idea was to interview policymakers, and it is very difficult. A lot of bureaucracy in interviewing policymakers in Portugal, maybe in the other place the same. So just to have an idea, we had to go to send several emails, several contacts to get one interview. And it was impossible, for example, to set a Skype interview. We interviewed four museum directors, and one of them of a UNESCO historic building, a monastery, very famous in Portugal. Two others related with one most visited archaeological site in Portugal, Funímbriga. And the other one in charge by the Museum of Ethnology in Lisbon. So we also interviewed, three presential interviews and one of them by Skype. We also interviewed in person academic in in charge, director of a research unit in intangible heritage, related to intangible heritage, and cultural heritage, and she's representing Portugal also in European boards, and a former university professor that is now very engaged with the community in spreading the word about the archaeological sites in his region, in south of Portugal, and academic, but also very engaged with the community regarding the archaeological practice and so on. So we hope to interview more people, but well, we got these 7 interviews. Okay, it's from December 2018, February 2019, and interviews were recorded and transcribed. So, this is more or less the guide, the main topics of the guide, interview guide, that you can see. So what are the most recognized Portuguese archaeological sites and other cultural heritage? Because we have also a second level of objectives that we took the opportunity to ask people about, which contributes more to Portugal country image, because this is a case study at this level. This is a case study, the Portuguese case. Is there any unified archaeological Portuguese image? How public policies, if any, can contribute to it? That is the problem. How do you promote Portuguese sites domestically and abroad? How can government and academy contribute to that? How do you assess it? To assess also another problem that you ought to assess. You'll see in the results. How do you make use of internet and social media to solve the problem of distance to the archaeological sites? We have a problem with the accessibility to some archaeological sites in Portugal, to make the value of heritage tangible and to get people engaged with them, and what are the unique aspects of Portuguese cultural heritage and the convergence points with an European identity. This point was not explored. Almost, we need to go further in, about this the convergence, the eventual convergence points with an European identity. So this is a second level, say, of our interest of research and our interview guide. I'll pass. And let's go to the main results regarding our open codifying process. So we start a codifying process through the software, but we stopped and then finish it by hand and and counting also. Counting by end the sentence and the words, but the first level of categories of an analysis that you got are these 6. So, archaeological practice for heritage, education, community engagement, visitor experience and tourism promotion, visitors profile, visitors perception and visitors experience assessment, visitors motivation, obstacles and limitations to the development of a Portuguese archaeological and cultural heritage image, social media as a mean for communicating archaeological and cultural heritage, how Portugal is unique and different, convergence points with European culture, the lack that you have in this study, a limitation, Portuguese sites and cultural heritage of interest for visitors, tourists and touristic promotion. Okay, so it seems in the first category of analysis, the things that was really underlined by most of them, and maybe for, now I cannot remember, but I think it was for all of them, the importance of the involvement of local communities in the preservation memory, and also in the free work, the value co-creation. They involve themselves, they engage themselves in this kind of activities for free. It's amazing what people can do for free and with enthusiasm. So, and in this case with a lack of financial support sometimes. And the UNESCO endorsement. impacting tourism and impacting, of course, the attraction of visitors. So it seems important to involve people and the communities in excavations and other heritage-related tangible and intangible activities. Partnership with schools for the students to visit the museum or the excavation sites seems to be also important and represent the future, of course, of these heritage brands. Recognition, dissemination, brand building heritage projects, including UNESCO endorsement. The role of social media and cultural heritage identity building was also recognized. And another important aspect that was referred was the high-skilled and talented people of the local tourism industry as a way to attract people to visit these heritage sites. So, regarding visitors' profile, they refer a lot Brazilian because it's the connection to the ancestrality, to the origin, to the old. We are the old world for Brazilian people, and nowadays we have also there are a lot of interest from U.S. people and some people from South America as well, like Venezuela, for example. Because the all these origins, and also from people, of course, always from Europe. For example, curiosity in the Museum of Ethnology, the director referred the importance of French visitors because we have in the collection there are pieces and material from the ex-French colonies. Okay, so they are very interested on that. Another category, visitors' perceptions and visitors' experience assessment, visit motivation. Okay, my feeling is they don't have a proper formal way to assess this. So they gave me guess most of the time, was guess. But it's interesting to understand their guess as well. So, but the main visitors' motivation, again, go to the origins, the UNESCO recognition, it was common, and education of future generations. To feel, experience also the city's environment. That was recognized as the main way to attract these people. Then they decide to visit also the heritage site, of course, when they visit the city, and the museum and so on. So visitors' perception, authenticity, were seen as authentic, antiquity, exclusivity, preservation. Some sites are considered preserved, and in that case, they attract more people. Go to the origins, in particular for foreign visitors. And well, the assessment that they told me is about the number of domestic visitors, most of the time domestic and not so much international, and the awareness among visitors about our cultural identity. But how they measure this awareness was not clear for me. Okay. So, regarding obstacles and limitations to the development of a Portuguese archaeological and cultural heritage image, the inaccessibility of the sites, that was seen like a real problem. Sometimes we have many years in Portugal, very interesting. One of them referred that like when a symbol in the Iberia, however, it's difficult to get them. So, and no investment. To make roads and ways to get these sites. Another problem, for example, was referred was the important historic buildings that nowadays are completely unrecovered because they are in private hands, because nobody wanted to pay for them. So that is a problem. Sometimes now it's not the owner, it's the child of the owner or the grandchild of the owner, and that is a problem to know who is the real owner in order to acquire these buildings. So lack of resources to manage, for example, social, I'm talking about important museums in Portugal, and they said, okay, I don't have nobody nowadays to manage the social media presence. That is a problem for them, okay? So lack of investment in public archaeology was another aspect referred. I'm sorry about this is my mistake, bureaucracy. This is a mix between Portuguese and English, it's not the correct word. So bureaucracy, always, and distance between people and communities. lack of interinstitutional collaboration. I'm going to give an example. Some board was included in the project, a director of a museum was included in the project. He didn't know, but then the project was supported. And so he was informed that please sign because you are in this project that was financially supported. Well, was a good news for one hand, but a bad news for the other hand because he didn't know I was involved in the project. So you can see this kind of 1 minute, great. So, and lack of skills for tourism and other professional related tourism, and this was recognized as important. So, regarding social media as a means for communication, archaeological and cultural heritage, this was completely recognized, but a problem with resources. And how Portugal is unique and different, convergence points with the European culture. As I said, I'm not going to focus on that because we need to study further. So geostrategy was referred, the geostrategy, the location of geographic location of Portugal between the eastern, something close to North Africa, but Atlantic and Europe, and in front of US, so it's interesting this was considered. One of the oldest countries with the oldest borders in the world and in Europe. An old and not so developed European country, so authenticity and then explore, but I would say we are losing this, so I don't know what to do when we lose the authenticity and then explorativity. Security and tranquility, always, of course. Landscape and ancient cultural diversity. Unique architectural style related with discoveries, because we have Manuelino. Manuelino is an architectural style that you have only, that exists only in Portugal, and interaction between the always the people, they refer to the people. It's not good for me, it's a lack of humility because I'm Portuguese, but they refer to the people, maybe it's perception. So the interaction of the people with the natural environment and the heritage, and of course our gastronomy was considered also cultural heritage. So I'll finish with this slide, I think, okay? So the regarding Portuguese sites and cultural heritage of interest for visitors, tourism and tourist promotion, they refer several, including a museum about one, they believe they are the oldest remains of writing in Iberia, in the south of Portugal, several buildings, UNESCO building, endorsed by UNESCO, Fado, of course, our national music, and gastronomy. So we essentially wanted to narrow the gap between the archaeological and cultural heritage knowledge and country image from a marketing perspective. Of course, somewhere there are a commercial sense here, and visitors, communities, and people are seen not only as consumers, but as co-creators of value and co-creators of this brand identity, this country brand identity. Thank you.